see you are there to talk about the misogynistic culture in South Asia. But don't forget, we are living in the male-dominating hall. So our next guest speaker is Mr. Altaf Hussain Wani. He is working as a director of programs and is also a member of All Party Hurriyat Conference. He has represented the Indian Occupied Kashmiris in United Nations Human Rights Commission in Geneva. I request to Mr. Altaf Hussain Wani kindly come to the podium and express his views. Thank you.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Honorable President, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I was asked to talk about the awareness and advocacy on human rights in Indian occupied Kashmir. I had prepared a long presentation for that. But since morning, you have listened to a lot of presentations, and I don't want to bore you anymore. Ladies and gentlemen, since the inception of this movement, the current uprising in occupied Jammu and Kashmir in 1989, or you may say the late 80s, a campaign and awareness program was launched by the government of Pakistan, government of Azad Kashmir, civil societies of Indian Occupied Kashmir, Azad Kashmir, and diaspora. This campaign is on. And we have seen, I must say, this campaign has been relatively a successful campaign. In a way, today we can see everywhere, in every corner of the world, the people are aware about the happenings in Indian occupied Jammu and Kashmir, about the human rights situation and all that. It was because of that campaign, the people who designed this campaign, who set out a drive for that, because of that, people from Pakistan, Azad Kashmir, and sometimes from Indian occupied Kashmir and leaders of all parties, Hurriyat Conference and civil society members, got chances to tour and travel to the different parts of the world to arrange seminars, to attend conferences, and also campaigns were organized internationally. And it was because of that we saw that at a point of time, Washington, Brussels, and London would hold regular conferences on Kashmir, and Kashmir was talked at each and every level, and is being talked at each and every international forum. But I must say, that's not all, because the rights violations are going on. We have not still achieved our goal, so there is no room for self-satisfaction. So we have to see, while we are lacking, why does our this campaign went wrong? Are there any lacunas in that campaign? Or what are the shortcomings of the campaign? And how can we overcome those shortcomings? That should be our concern today. Because as we are today observing the International Human Rights Day, and we got a chance to discuss about our rights also and about our campaign also. We did the campaign, and we are carrying the campaign. But to be a good advocate for human rights, to have a result-oriented advocacy on the human rights, the basic thing is that you should have a proper monitoring system of human rights violations. And then comes the documentation. Unfortunately, I must accept, as being part of the team, as being a campaigner, we lack both these things. To some extent, we have tried to overcome these basic limitations, but still I must accept, we are lacking. We are also only playing with the numbers. If I'll say in this hall that we say we have 10,000 police disappearances, but if I will tell anybody in this hall, can you name a single Indus person who was disappeared? Who was he? Why did he disappear? What happened to him? How many kids he had? Was he married or not? Nobody will know. We are only counting on numbers. So we have to devise a system of monitoring, documentation, proper documentation of the human rights violations. Only then we can move forward. I'll say that at present, I have been trying since last 2-3 years, I took to different university complex in all Azad Kashmir and different educational institutions to find out room for that. But unfortunately, till date, I failed to do that. I must accept. I didn't get the audience for that, to tell them that what needs to be done, what is the way to go forward. There was a, I would say, in 90s, when we came here, we'll see everybody in Azad Kashmir was involved in this movement. Be it a poet, be it a writer, a fiction writer, everywhere you will see new songs for the liberation and everything was there. But unfortunately, that started dying down. I could not see those writers today. I could not see those people today who could write. It was because they did not get the patronage. From this day today, this president is here, the secretary of liberation cell is here. I would like to request them that people who write, who promote the resistance literature, those people should be accommodated somewhere, they should be patronized, they should be encouraged, so that we should promote a resistance literature. This is one thing which I will request today from the state. The second thing, I would like to request the universities in Azad Jammu and Kashmir to arrange some awareness programs on how to advocate the human rights violations of the Indian occupied Kashmir. Only then we have a huge diaspora, but we must expect and all we should do this that we have failed to utilize the diaspora to its full potential because we are relying on the conventional supporters in diaspora. We have failed to create or to engage the young diaspora. The younger generation in diaspora is not aligned with this moment. So we have to train the people from Azad Kashmir, the young generation from Azad Kashmir, and give them chances to go out, to engage with their people in diaspora. So only that diaspora can speak the civil society of those countries. Only then we can engage the civil society in the countries they live in. It's not the traditional diaspora which we are using. That's good. But we should engage the new and young talented speakers from Azad Kashmir, the advocates from different fields, from academia and law and other things. They should go there and they should engage with the young ones and engage them, and we can have a better audience at the international forum. The third and final thing which I'll say, the using the United Nations mechanisms, available mechanisms, that we have totally failed to engage with them. We tried a lot, we are trying on it, but it's very small and not at a large scale. We failed to do it. If we will do that, you see, each and every person in this hall can approach the United Nations. For that, there is no necessary, you should be in Geneva, you should be there at India office, you should have an organization for that. Any individual can do it. There is a procedure for that. You can engage that complaint procedure of United Nations. You can send your complaints to the procedures division, to the communication section, and thereby they can be transferred to the related state, and they can act on that. That you can do. That only you have to do first. You have to be remain informed about what is happening on the other side of the line of control. And you have to create interest in yourself and to carve about that news, what's coming out, to see it's right and left, just not what's coming on the newspaper or the figure that's figuring in that you count on that. That will not do. And similarly, There is the procedures of Human Rights Council. Human Rights Council has a set of mandates for that. You can set complaints to the different mandate holders in the council. For that also, you need not to be a member of any organization. Anybody can do that. I have that performa also. You can fill up that performa. You can send an email to any special reporter. That will be reflected in the report. Mind it, nothing goes waste. Anything you send to them, that will be reflected in their reports if you do that. If you will do these things, I think we can move ahead, we can engage more people, we can make India accountable for what she is doing in Indian-occupied Kashmir. You saw the world is recognizing the work of human rights defenders. You saw the Parveena Ahanger, the Parvez Imroz, who got the Raftway Award from Norway. That's because of their work on human rights. That is the resilience of Kashmir. We saw the people in this conflict. They have risen up. Even in this conflict, the people who wrote fictions on this conflict, the collaborators, the curfew nights, you might have heard about that. If you go through those people rose to the now in the, you see, now we have editorials in Washington Post, New York Times, or in other journalists. These are those boys from Indian occupied Kashmir who are on the editorial board and are writing about Kashmir. You can do that. Only thing is that firstly, we have to get involved in it, and I think Mr. President has a long experience of international diplomacy, and we can be benefited by his experience if we can take time from the President, and President will educate the younger generation how to be good ambassadors of rights advocacy at international level. And Mr. President, I would also like to request you, until we give incentives to our younger generation to write on Kashmir, nobody will write on it. I'll make a request to the President, being the Chancellor of the universities, writing a paper on Kashmir should be compulsory for every scholar, but he should be given an incentive for that. While doing a research or a PhD in physics, chemistry, or any other subject, he will do the research on physics and chemistry until we give him a chance that he will be incentivized if he write on Kashmir, if he'll do a research paper on Kashmir. So he will have the interest in that. And I think Mr. President can do that. With this, I beg leave from you. Thank you very much.
Tip talk, and particularly related to our responsibilities. Our next respected guest speaker is Dr. Shaheen Akhtar. She is working as associate professor in international relations, and she is also the editor general of contemporary studies at National Defense University. Her areas of expertise is South Asia, regional security and stability, conflict resolution and peace building, non-traditional security and foreign policy of major powers. I request to Dr. Shaheen kindly share your views. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I'm grateful to be invited here to share my views. Very moving, inspiring speech by Altaf, and I agree with him that a younger generation should focus on Kashmir, who is working on her MPhil thesis on this very subject, especially focusing on the legitimacy of the Kashmiri struggle in the current context. So, but I do feel that students working on Kashmir should be encouraged. The subject they are assigned to me is very fundamental and very interesting, but very challenging as well. All our basis of Kashmir cause is on say the right of self-determination for the people of Kashmir. What are the context when we started really focusing on that and thinking that how it is really as a concept, how it has evolved over a period, and how basically this concept or the notion has relevance in the dispute or conflict, and then in the current context, what can be done, how we can really use it, how we can project it in support of the Kashmir cause, Kashmir struggle, which is frankly speaking have been under a lot of pressure since 9/11. The argument that I'm trying to build is basically Kashmiri has yet to exercise their right of self-determination to freely determine their political status. So we will find this invariably as part of right of self-determination in all the international instruments, UN Charter, UDIR. So there's a basis for that one political status. The other one is to freely pursue their economic, social and cultural development. Again, it is being enshrined in the UN Charter, in the UN Resolution, and the International Covenant on Economic and Political Rights and Cultural Rights. So this are just trying to blend both, and it's very interesting to see the way the concept has evolved. There's an increased focus on the internal self-determination at the moment, and there's a dilemma how we really build an argument which is not really sacrificing the larger context in which the concept has developed, which was the colonial context. If you look at the general definition of the self-determination, you'll find that it is about the right of the people to determine their own destiny. This is the phrase that we come across when we talk about the Kashmir cause and the freedom movement. In particular, it allows the people to choose its own political status. It's a political issue which has to be determined by the people of Kashmir. And the nature of that is how you basically determine the political status of that. The other one is basically to determine their own form of economic, cultural, and social development. You have seen in the earlier presentation and speeches, a lot of references being made to the fundamental human rights which have been consistently violated by the occupation forces, and that is basically, to my mind, is very much linked to the denial to the people of Kashmir to determine their political status. So there is an intricate linkage between the two which we can build and go for the projection of this right of self-determination. It has evolved over a period from the principle, as it started with, and then it acquired the status of a legal norm, which we find in both the international covenants. Current debate, I will be brief because I know I have limited time, but very specific to the point. The earlier context was, as I said, the colonial context, which was linked to the decolonization process of larger in Africa and Asia. You will see that was basically the classical the colonial context, but now it has moved from that to from the external self-determination, where these people got the liberation, independence, to their own internal, cultural, political, economic development at the moment, which is largely the internal self-determination. And you will find many arguments being extended by the Indian scholars saying mostly that is no more the case of external or full self-determination, but more of a internal self-determination. The evolution process starting from the World War I, where the concept was incipient, it has not been mentioned in a way that we see today, but in the Woodrow Wilson's statements and all that, he referred to it as an imperative principle of action. Then you see after the World War II and in the 60s, the concept evolved and was extensively used in the decolonization process. In fact, the 60s and 70s were the period when you find this notion was at his peak. In fact, it's very interesting to see the Kashmir, say, dispute is very much part of that period. See, it has roots in 48, 47 in the partition. So it is very much in the colonial context. We should not really compromise on that. Specifically, looking at the right of self-determination, and it is being enshrined in the UN Charter. You see Article 1 saying that.